Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Maxon booth here at NAB 2019. I'm Matthias, a.k.a. Major Effects. So for all of you out there who don't know, you can tune in live at c4dlive.com. We're giving away thousands of dollars of prizes from a number of our different partners. So check that out. If you guys haven't, you can pull out your phones, jump on C4D Live. We're also chatting on YouTube, Vimeo. We're doing live stream globally. So everybody, enjoy. You guys are here because we have tons of artists that are showing you their techniques and inspiring you to be able to add more creativity to your workflow and hopefully some tools that will show you things that you haven't seen before. So I'm always learning, and one of my amazing inspired artists that I'm so happy to have, we've had him on the roadshow a number of years ago. We talked and it was last minute and I said, well, show me what you worked on. And he showed me his reel, and I was just like, yes, you're coming out. They'll love you. So, ladies and gentlemen, Handel Eugene.
Thank you, Matthias. All right, let's start this timer, huh? Seriously, thank you guys so much for joining me here at the Maxon booth. My name, again, is Handel Eugene. I'm incredibly grateful, humbled to be here among such an incredible lineup. Let's take a look at some of my best work and what I've been up to for the last 8 years.
Can you please turn yourself down? Fighting from computer trenches.
Thank you. First off, I want to say thank you to Matthias so much. Appreciate it so much for having me come out here. Thank you to Maxon and everybody. Incredibly grateful to be here, like I said. Thank you to Matthias for making me follow up Andrew Kramer. I'm still picking my jaw up off the floor from that last presentation. But I want to say thank you to everybody who's watching online. Hey Ma, hey Dazi. The title of this presentation is called 3D Design and Illustration. And what we're going to look at is how we can take 2D illustrations, 2D designs, 2D assets, and translate them into a 3D environment. I'm terribly excited to share with you guys the projects that I brought with me today. We're going to look at my workflow. We're going to look at my techniques like, you know, projection mapping. We're going to look at techniques like UV unwrapping, 2D lighting and texturing. And hopefully by the end of this presentation, you can have a good understanding of how you can kind of achieve some of the 3D aesthetics you see in my work. So let's start off with this first project I worked on during my time at Royale. The client was Prudential, and my art director, Heather Aquino, did an amazing job. Heather Aquino and her team did an amazing job with these illustrations that you see here. And my job, my responsibility, was to take these illustrations and bring them into a 3D environment to do some 3D animation. So enough talking. Let's just jump into Cinema 4D. Let me go ahead and show you guys how I went about doing that. So let's open up some of these Cinema 4D project file. Okay, so this is the final scene. Let's go ahead and dive in. Let's kind of take a look under the hood at some of these, inside of some of these null objects. So if I jump around, rotate a little bit, you can see this scene and what we got going on. So it's actually really simple. I'm going to open up some of these null objects so we can look at some of the objects that we have here. Object that we're very familiar with. You know, we have our cube objects. We've got some sweep objects. For our roof, we're using a sweep object here like so. For our door, we're just using a primitive cube. For our doors, in our chimney, we're using a Boolean object like so to kind of cut out the hole in the top. If you're familiar with the Pathfinder tool in Illustrator, it's a very similar technique. But what I really want to kind of break down and create from scratch are some of these bushes that we have here. So let me twirl this open up some of these bushes. So I want to break down some of these bushes. So let's create this from scratch. Let's jump into a new scene. I'm hitting Command N to jump into a new scene. We're going to go in and drop in a sphere into our scene. And honestly, we're already 90% there. But what we need to do is just go to our coordinates tab and under the scale and the X, we're going to need to scale this down to kind of skew the proportions a little bit. So like 0.6, 0.5 will get us kind of close to where we want to go. We go into our object tab. We're going to change the type to a hemisphere. Click on that guy. And really, the only thing left we want to do is add a deformer to this sphere. The deformer we're going to use is the shear deformer. So if we drop that into our scene, so this is a new feature. That's cool. If you have your object selected with your deformer, drop it in, it automatically makes it a child of the sphere. That's cool. Didn't know that. So if you click fit the parent to make sure that it's within the size of your geometry. I like to scale it up just ever so slightly just so I know it's all contained within. And we're just going to increase the strength here like so. And right now it's actually going in the wrong direction. It's coming towards us. We want to kind of shear it left and right. So we're just going to rotate that 90 degrees like so, holding down shift to snap the 10 degree increments. And let's do that again, increase the strength. And that'll shear our sphere a little bit. Right now we've got this curvature going on, so I just want to eliminate that, just bring that down to 0%. And this will kind of give us the distorted proportions that we're looking for. In almost Dr. Seuss-like way. This is kind of applying those illustration techniques into our 3D environments using deformers. So our last thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to double up these segments just so we can kind of smooth out these edges on this sphere. And that's the gist as far as the modeling aspect of our bushes. Next thing I want to kind of demonstrate for you guys and break down, and what I think kind of really makes this scene appealing is the texturing aspect. So this tree that we got here, I want to open up a new scene and kind of look at and break down some of these materials that we used on this particular tree. So I got a project file already created, so let's just open this guy up. And we'll quickly look at how we created this. Nothing fancy, super simple, all primitive objects. We're using the sphere and using the technique that we just looked at, where we're just adjusting the scale in the Z-axis to kind of get, like I mentioned, those kind of exaggerated proportions. And we're just using cylinder objects, again, with the scale along the Z-axis, skewing that a little bit. So one thing we did add is another deformer I'll show you guys here quickly. If we jump into our deformers, we've got this taper deformer. So if I hold down shift, actually, we don't need to do that anymore, apparently. Look at that. We don't even need to hold down shift. So if you have your object selected and you click on a deformer, it would automatically make it a child of that deformer. Just click on that deformer, go to object, click fit to parent. And if we adjust the size down a little bit, I'm going to scale that up, holding down T, clicking and dragging. Bring that down a little bit like so. Maybe make it a little bit bigger. And then we're going to rotate that 90 degrees, holding down shift to snap to 10 degree increments. Move that towards the bottom a little bit. And then we just increase the strength. We're going to get like this nice billowing effect towards the bottom of our tree. Nothing crazy, nothing complex, but it's the simple thing. It's a simple yet effective technique to kind of get those illustrative results that you see inside of illustration, often you see inside illustration, and applying those into 3D. So let's look at how we can texture this guy. So let's drop in the first material. I've got these two materials already loaded. Nothing crazy, nothing fancy. Just all they are is just colors. It's just the color channel being applied. So if I hold down Command, click and drag to duplicate this material to the tree trunks, this will get us our base, and we'll create the rest of the materials from scratch from here for this tree. So let's double-click inside our material manager, create a new material, and turn off reflectance. And this is going to be our gradient material. I've got some numbers already written down here, so we can kind of enter those in really fast. 161 by 86 by 88. And this is going to be our gradient. Now, normally, here, if I drag and drop this onto my tree, you'll see that it applies the material on the right-hand side. It overrides the material underneath it. And normally with gradients, you know, in the same goes for Photoshop and such, you'll create a gradient all in one material or all in one layer. But the technique that I like to use, I like to use the alpha channel to kind of create this tapering, feathered effect to kind of blend between materials. Let me show you what I mean by that. So if you double-click on this material, we go into our alpha channel, and under texture, we're going to load in a gradient like so. So once we drop in a gradient, it's going to drop in this black and white gradient, and where it's black, it's going to be completely transparent. Where it's white, it's going to be completely opaque. So it creates this feathering effect, which is what I'm trying to go for. So right now it's going from left to right. I actually want to invert that. I want to swap those. So if I right click in my gradient, invert gradient, it swaps those materials, those swatches, and then I'm going to click on my material tag, and we've got some attributes in here that we can use to kind of translate and transform our gradient. So I'm going to adjust the scale a little bit like so, get this down to like 50%. So now we've got like this nice gradient going from left to right, and I like to use this method because it gives me a little bit more flexibility. We're only using two shaders here, but in previous projects I've used 3, 4, 5, 6 different materials stacked and layered on top of each other and blending between each other using the alpha channel. And so that's going to give us our gradient. And let's add one more material. This last material is we're going to call this highlight, HL for short. We're going to turn off reflectance. We don't need that. Again, we've got some values here that I've already written down. We'll just enter those in. 170 by 114 by 140. And this is going to be our highlight. So again, if I drop this onto my tree, you'll see it overrides all the material. The material on the furthest right will override all the materials to the left. So all we need to do is turn. So right now, if I adjust the length, or if I translate this, we're not seeing anything happen. And that's because this material is tiling. It's tiling infinitely. So what I need to do is turn off tile. Once we do that, look here. We can rotate. We can adjust the. Basically, it looks like we're moving it, but we're actually adjusting the scale, and we're getting this nice little highlight effect along the edges of the tree. Again, so if we jump back to our reference really fast, you can see our mouse. So yeah, like I'm trying to get like these nice little highlight effects that you see in some of these illustrations along some of these edges along the trees. That's where this highlight comes in. And that's essentially how we've created our tree. Our tree looks, if we render this, this is what our tree looks like. It looks interesting, but it's not exactly the same as what we have in our final scene. And that's because of lighting. And we'll take a look at the lighting process now. So each one of these lights, we're going to turn off all these lights, and we'll break them down one by one. So once I turn off the light, you'll see the scene changes drastically. It's a little more bland. It's a little more muted. It's a little bit more dull. So obviously, lighting is a major component in a scene like this. So let's jump in, and let's start off by looking at our key light. Let's break that down for a second. So our key light, we've got off into the distance here to the right. Actually, there's nothing fancy about this light. It's default Omni light, right? So if you drop in a light, it's a defaults to Omni. And I've changed, everything is the same, right? There's nothing I've changed except for this little kind of switch that we see here. It's actually the secret sauce, truthfully, honestly, for this whole scene. It's this switch called ambient illumination. Fun challenge. Try and say ambient illumination 3 times fast and see how far you get. But what is ambient illumination? Ambient illumination is... essentially, what it does is it lights all the objects in your scene with the same intensity. It creates this flatter look where only the material color is considered. All right, so essentially, it just gets rid of the 3D shading in your scene. If we turn ambient illumination off just to demonstrate what it's doing, this is the effect that we get. And now there's complete 3D shading in our scene. Obviously, these elements back here are falling into darkness. This element here is closer to the light, so therefore it's brighter, whereas these elements back here are a little bit darker because they're further away. But with ambient illumination, we get rid of all that 3D shading, that 3D aspect, and it creates this flatter look. which is interesting, right? When you say flat look, like that sometimes it has like a negative connotation, but in this particular scene, it's exactly what we're going for because, again, we're kind of referencing these design frames inside of here. You want to try and match this look and illustration. So ambient illumination is the key component there. So then we have what we call our fill light. I've got that off into the distance over here on the right-hand side. So if I turn my fill light on, actually, here, let me turn that off for a second. Let's look at these bushes right here, right? Look at this bush and look at this bush. And when I turn on my fill light, you can kind of really see what it is that's happening. I'm reintroducing back in some of that 3D volume, that 3D shading. Ambient illumination got rid of the shading, and that's actually what we want, but we do want to get some volume and some information and like those gradation of tones. You want to kind of introduce those back in, but subtly. That's why I only put the intensity down to 65%. I didn't want this to be too, I didn't want to introduce too much 3D shading, but I did want to get some volume in there, some nice little gradation of tones. So the last light we'll look at here is our shadow caster. We're actually going to create that from scratch. So if I drop in a light into my scene, my shadow caster, so if I drop my light and I bring this up, right? You can see this light right here, actually here, let's turn this light and we're going to add shadows. We're going to use area shadows. Now, we actually can't, if we want to see our shadows, actually we can. Boom, it's working. So sometimes right now we can see our shadows in our scene, but sometimes you may or may not see your shadows. If you don't see your shadows in your viewport, you go under options and make sure the shadows is enabled, because sometimes that's off or on by default depending on your scene or version of Cinema 4D. So, but yeah, so we're getting some shadows in our scene, right, like so, but it's blowing out our building, right? Our building's completely white. It's clipping some of those color values. And that's not what we want. So we still want, so essentially what we want to do is we want to have shadows, but we don't want to increase the brightness overall of our scene. Now you might think to reduce the intensity of the light and that might fix your problems, but we're reducing the intensity of the shadows at the same time. And so what if there was a way to just have a light that only casts shadows and doesn't emit any light? So we can do that. What if I told you? Go into the details tab and under this little switch guy right here, shadow caster, appropriately named, click on that guy and boom, we get nothing but shadows and no light. So now we can move this like so into place. Now if I move this over here, we can really see a good demonstration of kind of what we're getting. And this is a really cool effect. I actually like the way this looks, and this is kind of like, you'll see this in illustration where your shadows fall to complete black, but it's not, it doesn't match our reference frames and our designs and such like that. Our shadows are very, very soft in our design frames, so we need to just go into our shadow tab and reduce the density down to 35%. That'll get us where we want to go. And the last thing I love to do, and this is kind of like a technique that I utilize in a lot of projects in my work, especially when I'm going for this illustrative style, is the color. So the color is completely black. And what I like to do is I'd like to tint my shadows. I'm a big fan of not using 100% white, 100% black. I like to introduce some colors into my shadows, especially for scenes like this. It kind of makes things kind of make things feel all in harmony and such, and then it kind of almost makes it a little bit warmer and such. So I like this. I'm going to go with the darker purple instead of 100% pure black. So last thing I want to demonstrate for you guys is the lighting tool. So this is a tool that's underutilized. Not a lot of designers may know about it, but it's a super helpful tool. And we'll get it demonstrated with the shadow caster. So under tools, lighting tool. So if you drop that into our scene, we're going to switch the mode to surface, and with your light selected here, we can interactively light our scene. Right now we're only looking at shadows because this is our shadow caster, but we can interactively, based off just clicking on surfaces, we can move our light around and rotate it and kind of get the angle that we want. So this is a very, very helpful technique. Whenever you're lighting, it works with any lights inside of Cinema 4D. It also works with third-party renders like Redshift and Octane as well. That's it for this scene. Oh, actually, no, we're not done yet. The scene is officially lit. It's a bad joke. It's a dad joke. Actually, it's not. We actually have to do one more thing. So let's drop in a, we got to add in global illumination. global illumination, the default settings are perfectly fine. And then we're going to add some ambient occlusion, which is going to give us some contact shadows throughout our scene. And like I said, with the shadows, the shadow caster, I'm a big fan of tinting my shadows, whether it be in lights or ambient occlusion. So let's move away from pure black. Let's just get some color into those different areas. Like so, and I like this makes things feel a lot warmer, a lot nicer. So let's see what the final results look like. So this is the scene, and hopefully you can see, just based off of that, those simple examples, how you can kind of achieve some of these illustrative results with very minimal effort using Cinema 4D. All right. Oh, I'm not done. Oh, if you like that. Oh, if you like that, stay tuned. We've got more. We've got a lot more to talk about. So those were just some simple examples, some simple executions. We're going to move into some more intermediate to advanced territories as we progress, namely projection mapping. So those who may not be familiar, projection mapping is a technique that allows you to project 2D images onto 3D surfaces. It's a popular technique in VFX, especially with matte painting. But for our purposes, we're going to look at how we can project 2D illustrations onto 3D geometry to kind of give it that additional dimensionality and depth. So the project that I brought with me today is a small little project I worked on for Marvel Studios called Spider-Man Homecoming. And really, really fast, big shout out to Perception Studios and Marvel Studios for clearing these assets for me to be able to show you guys today. There definitely was an in-depth approval process. So thank you to Johnny and Eric in Perception for working so hard to fight to get these assets cleared and greenlit to show you guys today. All right, let's take a look at the shot we'll be breaking down. This was designed by the talented Chris Carboni, who did an amazing job on this shot and many other shots for the title sequence. And he handed this file over to me, and he's like, here, just make it move, make it animate. And that was my job. My responsibility was take this design and give it, add it some animations, some dimensionality and depth. Let's jump into Cinema 4D. Let me show you how I use projection mapping techniques to animate this shot right here. So executing a shot like that starts inside of Photoshop. So if we drop this in here, let's take a look under the hood here, and let's open up, close. Let's open up this Chris's design frame. And if we open this up, we can see the different layers for this shot here that we got here, and this is a obviously an amazing illustrated file, but we've got an issue. Often is the case, or rarely is the case. Do you ever take a design file and just automatically bring it into After Effects and start animating, or bring it into Cinema 4D and start animating? There always is some preparation involved with files like these, and this shot, this design file is no different. So we want, my goal is to kind of have these layers and these such animating up. I want the whole sandwich to be moving, and I want the layers to kind of be separating as they're animating up. So if they start separating, we're going to kind of run into some problems, right? We got some gaps, and we've got some holes inside of here that once these layers separate will reveal kind of like these undesirable, unwanted gaps. So I needed to go in and paint in some of these holes. So that was the first major big step when... Oh, let's navigate back to our file. Nope. That was the first big step I needed to do. So I essentially went in, I put everything out of the groups and put it all in the same hierarchy, and I went in and filled in those gaps. We used Kyle's brush presets, if you're familiar with those, for these illustrations. So I just took his same brush and went in and just kind of filled in those gaps, so that way when I bring this into Cinema 4D, I can properly animate them without getting those holes and those gaps. All right, let's jump into Cinema 4D and let's project this onto some geometry, huh? So I've got a project file already set up. We've got a camera with a projection tag. If I delete that really fast, right-click Cinema 4D, protection tag, you can see where I got that tag from. And essentially, this is locking down our camera. We don't want our camera to move when we're doing projection mapping. And we've got if we go to our render settings, we've got our output already set up to the film aspect ratio that we want. and I've already got our illustration loaded in. So let's look inside of our projection camera, and we're going to drop in a background object. And we're going to take this illustration, drag and drop it onto our background object. So we've got our illustration, and what I'm going to do is start blocking out. We're going to look at how we're going to. I'm going to demonstrate this layer, this sandwich here. So let's block out the top red, the top portion of this sandwich. All right. So I'm just going to take this cube. I'm going to move it over, holding down R to rotate. I'm not going to get too precious with this right just yet. So I'm just trying to get a rough blocked out version of the top of our sandwich. I just want it to cover up all of our sandwich. And I want to get somewhere close. All right, done. Looks great. No, not yet. Now we're going to rename this to top bread. And I'm going to put this into a group, which will make sense here in a second. You'll know why. So double click. I'm going to call this sandwich 03. And now what we're going to do is we're going to take this illustration that we have here So we're going to turn off our background object for now. And we're going to take this illustration. We're going to drag and drop it onto our group. And so once we do that, you can see that obviously this looks a little funky. This looks wrong. This is off. And what's happening is it's mapping the whole design frame onto one layer. But what we want is we want this material to project. We want to project the illustration onto the geometry. And the way we do that is telling our material to, instead of projection UVW mapping, we want to switch to projection camera mapping. And so now it looks actually worse, but we gotta do one more thing. We've got to tell this material, hey, what camera do we want to project? Under this camera slot, what camera are we using as our projector? And it'd be drag and drop, or, you know, some people drag and drop. I like to do the click and drag swag. Drop that in there. I'm two for two with my dad jokes. I'm on a roll. And that will use this camera as a projection. So we're pretty close. This is obviously a lot better, but we don't see our bread. And that has to do with our aspect ratio right now. We have the wrong aspect ratio right now. It thinks that we're doing 4:3. We just got to click calculate, and that will calculate the right aspect ratio. So that's an important button to not forget for this to work properly. Once you click calculate, then we're starting to get somewhere where we want to be. So let's take this bread. We can just manipulate it and move it again a little bit. I'm going to rotate this down like so. Scale it ever so slightly to get us in a rough position. And right now we've got some 3D shading going on, right? This face of this layer is brighter than the top, right? Because that has to do with the default light, the 3D shading. And we want to eliminate. We want to get rid of all the 3D lighting in our scene, right? So what do we got to do? We got to drop in a new light and use the technique that we just learned, right? Ambient illumination, which gets rid of all the 3D shading in our scene, which of course is exactly what we want. We don't want there to be any type of 3D shading to affect. The design itself has its lighting and shading already embedded in it, so we just want to use the design frame. This is good. We're in a good place. We have the whole illustration being projected onto the top bread, and what we want is to only have the top bread itself being projected onto this layer. So what we need to do is I'm gonna take this illustration, hold down Command to click and drag to duplicate, and I'm gonna call this top bread. We're gonna turn off the reflectance. We don't need that, and go into our color channel, and we've got we've got this PSD right already loaded. This is important because it's a PSD. We go inside of our material. We've got this thing called layer set. So some people may or may not know, but if you load in a PSD file into your materials, you actually have access to the Photoshop layers. So under this layer set, so if we click select, all the layers that we had in the Photoshop document, we have access to now, and we can select them individually. So let's click on the top bread like so, and hit OK, and now we can solo just that layer. So now we've got the top bread, right? So we got the top bread loaded in, but we've got all this black area, and we want that to be transparent. So all we need to do is just copy channel. So click on this little guy here, copy channel, go to an alpha channel, and paste shader, and we'll get rid of all that black area, and it'll be transparent. So Now all we need to do is we hold down Command. So we've got our camera mapping projections already set up, right? So now I'm going to hold down Command, duplicate, and duplicate that material to our top bread layer, right? Our top bread object. Okay, so now we're going to take this material, and we're going to drag and drop it on top of the material. Now check out what that does. That replaces our material, but still preserves all of our camera mapping projections. That's a handy technique, so that way you don't have to do all the steps over and over again. You can just duplicate the material, click and drag to swap it, and preserve all of its camera mapping settings. So now we can start manipulating the geometry and adding some volume, so that way this bread isn't so square. We want to give it some volume. We want to make this bread cool. It's too square. So let's go ahead and hit C to make this editable. And you can see this is what our projection looks like. We're projecting. If you think about it, right? Like projection mapping might seem like this dotting method, but if you just think about what you guys have all seen a projector being projected on the wall. You guys have walked in front of that projector, and that projector is projecting that image onto your body. That's essentially what we're doing here. We're projecting the design frame onto 3D geometry. So that's essentially what's happening. So we make that editable. Sorry, undo. We can't not make it editable. We got to add some segments first. So we're going to add 6. 1 is fine, and 2 on the Z. Then we're going to make it editable. Right now, it's projecting onto the back faces. We don't need those back faces. So let's get our live selection tool, go into polygon mode, and select those back faces, holding down shift, and deleting those guys, deleting this, hit delete, and getting rid of the polygons that we don't need. So that way, we're just dealing with the ones that we do. And so let's go into edge mode, or actually, let's go into point mode. And let's just go ahead and hold down shift to click and drag, select these points like so. I'm going to move this forward a little bit, going to move this up. And we're just going to kind of sculpt. We're going to kind of sculpt the volume of this bread. It actually looks a little wonky, and it doesn't look like I'm doing much, but you'd be surprised. This alone adds so much volume and depth to our layers and in animation. So I'm just tidying this up just a little bit like so. And that already is enough for our purposes. Obviously, when I was doing this, I was being a little bit more precious than I am for now. But for the sake of time, this is all we need for our purposes to demonstrate the effect. So that's our top bread. We've got some volume to it, some dimensionality. So let's go ahead. I'm going to hold down Command, Duplicate, and we're going to rename this to Meet 01. And I'm going to duplicate this top bread material, double-click, call this Meet 01, and we're just going to go in and replace, go inside, double-click, go into our layer set, select Meet 01, hit OK, and then copy this shader, go into our alpha channel, and click Paste. Stop doing that. And we're going to take this material, and we're going to drag and drop it onto our Meet 01. Again, utilizing that same technique, right? We don't need to reproject this material. We've already got it projected, and that will save us some extra time, some extra clicks. And so this looked a little funky, but all we need to do is just lower this down. Oh, you're fine. We're good. Yeah, we're good. I'm lowering this down and then just scaling this up a little bit just to kind of get our projection. And again, I would be a little bit more precious with this if I was doing this for real, but we're just wanted to demonstrate the process and then move on so we can kind of get to the rest of this. Now we move this back. Move this back. We want this to be inside the bread like so. Scale it up. Bada boom, bada bing, like so. All right, cool. And now let's do, okay, so what I just demonstrated, we would do that process, repeat that process, and that's exactly what I did. But what I just showed you is actually the manual way of doing it. And I kid you not, this weekend, Rick Barrett, shout out to him, the C4D master, humbled me real quick and showed me a way more efficient way of doing this. So if I duplicate this, let's call this Meet 02. Let's delete this material tag. Right? let's turn these off just for a second. Let's focus on just one layer. And there's this handy little module under window called Projection Man, fittingly enough. I don't know why I'm teaching a projection lecture and I never looked at Projection Man until this weekend. So this is all new information for me, and this is all new. This is why I love NAB. I'm learning new stuff at the same time. But here, let's drag this out. Okay, cool. If I drag this out of the material, you'll see that this is an unassigned object. So we've got our projection camera, we've got our PSD files, and these are all the layers. These are all the different layers that are being projected underneath this PSD file. So all you need to do, when you duplicate, you create a new layer or a new object, you can just click and drag and drop this into the Photoshop document, select the layer that you want. Oh, so this is going to be the tomatoes, and hit OK. And it applies those tomatoes automatically based off of the projection camera. And you can just duplicate, do the same thing, right? Duplicate, delete, drop this into the Photoshop document, select lettuce, hit OK. And then so now we're projecting all these different layers way faster than the different steps that we were doing earlier. And you just got to move them into place like so and just separate them like so and then bring these back up. And then you have these different layers. Let's jump into the final scene. This looks a little wonky, so let's jump into the final scene and see what this actually looks like, what the final version looks like. So if we open this up, you can see what all the different materials look like and the designs projected onto their respective geometry. And if we were just doing camera animation, if we were just like, you know, zooming, rotating, or what have you, this would be perfect. This would be, our job would be done, and majority of our work would be done. But like I said, I want these sandwiches to animate up, and I want their layers to separate, like I mentioned earlier at the top of this segment. So if we go into our projection camera, and if we move this sandwich like so, you'll see we run into an issue. The textures aren't sticking. Right, so that's obviously problematic for animation. And so what we need to do is we need to get these textures to stick onto the geometry. We need to bake the projection down to our materials. And the way we go about doing that is selecting this UVW tag and deleting it. Okay, we're going to delete that tag, and what we're going to do is we're going to select this material, go to tag, generate UVW coordinates. So now we're generating new UV coordinates that will essentially define new coordinates that will bake down our projection into our material, right? So right now, our material is set to projection camera mapping, but once we generate new V coordinates, these coordinates are now taking the projection settings and baking it down to 3D coordinates. So now this projection is now set to UVW, and now that top bread is sticking to our material. So we'll select the rest of these layers. Actually, sorry, the rest of these UVW tags, we're going to delete those. Select the rest of these, go to tags, generate UVW coordinates, and now we take our sandwich. Now it's sticking and it's moving. So let's jump into the final scene to see kind of like what this animation looks like. Now, so a shot like this could have easily been animated all inside of After Effects, right? But what we wanted to do on this project is we wanted to really utilize all the different tools that were at our disposal, and specifically Cinema 4D, to kind of add some depth and dimensionality to our illustration. We can jump into our keynote presentation and see what the final result looks like. We brought our animation into Photoshop to do some post-processing effects with Photoshop Actions, and then brought that back into After Effects to, well, as far as the process goes, we started in Photoshop, we went to Cinema 4D, went back to Photoshop to do some post-processing effects, and took all those assets, brought them into After Effects to composite them all together with traditional assets. So, like I said, using all the different tools at our disposal to kind of get the best effect that we wanted. Obviously, for a project like this, it's going to be on our film, we want to put our best foot forward and utilize all the different tools and techniques for their strengths, right? And Cinema 4D allows us to give that extra volume and depth that you just wouldn't get with 2.5D layers inside of After Effects. So let's look at a couple other examples that I brought with me of using projection mapping techniques. This was same sequence, same Spider-Man sequence. We're using projection mapping techniques to project our design illustrations onto this 3D bus. It's a subtle effect, but you know, in life, it's the subtle things. You know, subtle things that matter. So let's look at another shot. This is one of my favorite shots I've ever animated. It was designed by a talented Lars Lundberg, who did this illustration. This is all projection mapping techniques inside of Cinema 4D. And utilizing the same tools that we just went over. Right. This was another shot. This was done at the Furrow, Seth Eckerd's company, and this was Mark Conlin's illustration file that I used, projecting 2D illustrations onto 3D geometry. And this was a personal project that I worked on. This is the owl. I did the design and illustration and projected this illustration onto 3D geometry. As you can see here, again, utilizing those same projection mapping techniques. All right. Moving right along. How are we doing on time? All right, cool. All right, we're doing good. All right, so this brings us to our next topic of discussion, 2D texturing for 3D models. So this was a shot that, again, on Spider-Man Homecoming. Sometimes techniques like projection mapping or simple 2D texturing or 3D texturing inside of Cinema 4D won't get the job done. This particular shot, we needed the animation to be a little bit more dynamic. So we turned to other methods inside of Cinema 4D to help us execute that shot. So let's jump inside Cinema 4D again, and let's take a look at how we ended up animating this shot. All right. So let's go ahead and open up this scene file. Let's go to filter. Let's turn off our grid here so we can get a nice view of what our train looks like. So this train, I'm using the symmetry object. I'll turn those off for a second just so we can see. This is our base model that we have here. I'm using the symmetry object to mirror this portion of the train to the other side, and then using the symmetry object again to mirror it to the other side as well. This is one of those examples I learned early on in my career about like working smarter, not harder. We just work on one side of the train, and if it's symmetrical, just duplicate it to the other sides. So this is a simple train. Actually, it's if we go to display grid shading, it looks very simple. Nothing complex, but we've got some edges and some molds and such, so that way we can kind of use it as guidelines. But what I really want to do is I want to take this geometry and I want to lay it out onto a flat 2D image. Specifically, I want to try and take this geometry and lay out its UVs onto an image that we can take inside of Photoshop, and we can not only paint on top of, but we can also do some cell animation on top of as well. So as is often the case, well, actually here. So the way to go about doing that, first thing we need to do is we need to take a look at what our UVs look like. What's the current state of our UVs, okay? So to see what our UVs look like, this UVW tag, hold down shift and double click, and you can see what your UVs look like currently. And if you know, this is no bueno. This is not good. I can't even decipher what exactly is going on. This is hard for me to tell. I can't use this. So we need to, as is often the case, you'll need to relay out your UVs. And thankfully, there's a procedural way of doing that inside of body paint. And I know body paint is like a dark art for some artists, but I'll try to do my best to make this as painless as possible. But it's an essential portion of this process. So we're going to take these UVs, we're going to unwrap them, lay them out nice and neat, so that way we can use our UVs as guidelines inside of Photoshop of where we can paint, where we can illustrate, and where we can animate. So let's go ahead and dive into body paint UV edit. Go to layout, body paint, BP UV edit, and make sure we're in polygon mode here. Polygon mode, and hit Command A. We hit Command A, we're gonna select all of our polygons, and this little tab here called UV mapping, optimal mapping. This is the procedural way I was talking about. So if you just click on optimal cubic, it's already set on by default. If you just click apply, it's just one button, it's easy, boom. It lays out our UVs in a nice fashion, in a nice way. It's something that we can actually use. You can start to tell, you can start to distinguish what areas of the train are what. But there, as is often the case, you'll need to do some manual work to kind of get this to work exactly the way you need it to be. So we've got one small issue. If I go to texture mode, and get my live selection, and I select these, you'll see that this right here, these faces are floating. They're hanging. They're not attached to our geometry. And if you're unwrapping UVs and laying them out, you always want your polygons to kind of face their neighbor. You don't want them hanging and kind of, you want them as close to each other as possible, if not touching. So right now, this needs to be here, right? You can tell that all these faces need to be together and they need to be touching, so that way when we're painting in the right and correct area. So what we need to do is we need to select these elements, hold down shift, select all these guys, make sure you select all your faces like so. And if we click optimal cubic, as far as optimal mapping again, click apply, that doesn't give us what we want. We can see that the faces are still not connected. So sometimes optimal mapping won't work. That's where we try optimal angle. So optimal angle, and click apply, and boom, that gives us what we want. But this is good, this is great, except for the fact that we can't use this. The UVs are overlapping each other. And so we need to, if you're ever doing this process, you should never have UVs and polygons and such overlapping each other, because that creates a problem where you'll be painting in one area and it will paint in two areas on the geometry. So you want all your layouts, all your UVs to be separated and laid out nice and neat. So if I hit T to scale this down like so, hit R to rotate this guy. Come on. Move this over like so. And now we can use these layouts. This is good. This is where we need to be. So all we got to do is just create a new texture. If you go to File, New Texture, like so, we want to change this to about 1500 by 1500. We're going to hit OK. And now we've got a new texture. And if we go to our Layers tab, this is just like a Photoshop document, right? Whenever you open a new Photoshop document, you see a background layer at the bottom, right? The same is true here. So only thing we need to do is we've got this UV mesh here that serves as our guidelines, but this UV mesh isn't an actual layer. We need this UV mesh to be an actual layer inside of our layer panel, so that way when we open up Photoshop, we have our UV mesh as a guideline of where we need to paint. So so we got to create a new UV mesh layer. So under layer, create UV mesh layer. And so based off of whatever color you have here, it'll apply that UV mesh in that specific color. White is perfectly fine for our purposes. So if we go to layer, make sure our object is selected. I think I deselected my object. Go to layer, create UV mesh layer. Now we've got our UV mesh layer that is an actual layer that we can turn on and off, and we can open this up inside of Photoshop. So now we're done inside of body paint, I promise. All we need to do is go to File, Save Texture As. We're going to switch and make this a PSD document. Hit OK. And let's go to our navigate to the root folder. It's perfectly fine. This is temporary. Let's call this train UVs 01. And now we can jump inside of, let's open up that file to take a look and see what it looks like. Open it up inside of Photoshop. And so now we've got our Photoshop document. We can turn these UVs on and off, and we can start painting. So if we start painting in these different areas, we'll know where, obviously this is the front of our train, these are the windows, these are the sides. So let's, these are the tops, these are the roofs. So let's go ahead and open up the final PSD document that we ended up using in the title sequence. So like we mentioned before, we've got our UV mesh, like so, and we've got our design frames, like so. We've got all these different layers using Kyle's brush presets to paint these. So not only did we paint these, we actually did cell animation. So if you don't know, you can do cell animation inside of Photoshop. So if you go into Window, Timeline, we turn that on, you can see we've actually got some animation. So if I click and drag, you can see. So essentially, we're just redrawing the same design frame four times. four times, and we're holding it for two frames. We're holding our design frames for two frames. Now, our sequence is 100 and some odd frames long. We didn't do 100, and we didn't paint 100 cell animations. We only painted four, and we looped that sequence inside of Cinema 4D. So let's jump inside of Cinema 4D so we can see what this process looks like, where we can import in our cell animation onto our UVs. So if we just scrub through this, we can see what our cell animation looks like as an image sequence. We exported this animation now as an image sequence. Okay, so how do we import in this image sequence? So let's open up the final scene. Let's switch back to our startup layout. And I left this texture blank intentionally. So let's go ahead and load in that PSD, not that PSD, actually our image sequence. Let's load in our image sequence. Let's call this random. Turn off reflectance. We don't need that. And we're going to go on to our texture tab. No, not texture. Sorry. We're just going to load in. Let's navigate to that design file. Not the design file. Apologize. What you want to do is you want to load in the first image of your animation sequence. Just the first image. Click open. And let's just go ahead and apply that to our train. We open this up, drag and drop it onto here. And if you did everything correctly, you'll see that these guys, everything's lining up. And obviously it's here, and that's success. So let's go to display, go to grid shading so we can see what this looks like. Okay, so we've got our animation, but we don't see what the cell animation looks like. It's not animating in our scene. So the way we got to load in that whole sequence into our scene is we double click on our train, go into our train material, and up top there's this animation tab. And Cinema 4D is smart enough to know that if you load in one image and if it's part of a sequence, all you got to do is just click calculate. So right now the movie start frame, the movie end frame is 0 to 0. Just click calculate and you'll see it loaded in all those image sequences. You got 0 to 7, right? Our 8 animation design frames. So now we've got that texture loaded in. The only other thing we've got to remember to do is go into the mode and click loop. So that way this animation sequence is looping throughout the whole sequence. So once we do that, if we click and drag, click and scrub, we still don't see our animation inside of our viewport. That's because we've got one last thing we've got to do before this thing works. And if we go to our material, go to editor, this little checkbox right here, turn on animation preview, and voila. We've got animation, ladies and gentlemen. That's our animated sequence into our scene. And right now, our preview is actually a little low res. So if we go into editor under texture preview size, if we go to no scaling, click on that guy, it'll sharpen that up. I don't know if you guys can tell up there, but it sharpened up our preview. So that way you can really see what our animation is looking like. So it's looking pretty good. So let's break down. Let's take a look and see what this scene looks like. I'll break it down for you guys quickly. So the biggest thing in this scene, the biggest driver we have going on is what's called a spline wrap, which is just a deformer, where if I turn that off, this is our train, like so. And we're wrapping our train using the spline wrap. We're wrapping our train using this circle spline. All right, circle spline wrapping. We're using the cloner object to duplicate this train multiple times, right? To clone it up top there. Using the cloner object to clone it multiple times and taking that cloner object and wrapping it along a spline wrap. So all we got to do, and the offset. The offset is what's driving this animation like so. Going back and forth. All right, so and that's about it. That's essentially how we went about creating this this sequence. So let's jump back into our presentation. And this was the final animation. We brought this back into Photoshop to paint along using cell animation to add some additional kind of that handcrafted feel and elements to our shot. You'll see that all throughout the sequence if you go online and watch it. And let's look at a couple other examples of me unwrapping UVs and painting inside of Photoshop. So this is a project that I'm pretty proud of that I worked on with Chris Griel. Shout out to him, who brought me in to work on this fun collaboration project called Bottled Up. I ended up creating 27 different emojis and unwrapping their UVs and painting them. So like one of the things I discovered and I learned on this project that's pretty cool is like if you saw this element right here, like this is painted in, right? These are painted in, these blemishes, these blushes, all that elements was painted in. And if you saw the final result, you might think like, hey, that lip is being created inside of 3D, that little highlight underneath. But no, it's actually, I'm painting in the highlights and the shadows and just placing those in right underneath the lip inside of 3D. So it's a combination of 3D. These highlights up top of here that you see here, that's all painted inside of Photoshop as well. So ended up doing 27 different emojis for this shot. And just to bring this full circle, majority of the textures were created inside of Photoshop for this scene, but this guy right here we need to have a more unique highlight along the edges. Again, trying to match the design frame. That's why I love working with illustrators, is because they really push your aesthetic, right? You're trying to apply these 2D illustrative results inside of 3D, and so that's what I had to do I had to unwrap the UVs of this tree to try and get that nice little highlight, and the same goes for the tree inside this scene. That's all I got. Really fast, really fast. I want to give a big shout out to my wife, who's sitting in the crowd today. She's my backbone. She's my support. I wouldn't be up here without her. So thank you to her. Thank you to my daughter who's watching online. Thank you guys for joining me. This is my website. This is my information. You can find all. You can hit me up. If you got any questions about this presentation, feel free to hit me up on there. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.